All right, let's get to the breakdown and understanding of the actual build. Let's go ahead and take a look at gear first, because that's what everybody is always excited to see. The majority here is for the gloves. You really want the Shadow Ops Flare, increasing the critical attack damage by 135% for all Shadow Ops attacks. I was also told that the critical attack damage is actually multiplicative and not additive. But we'll go ahead and take a look at that and see a little bit more into the actual video. I personally love running the pistol damage or the pistol shots over the high caliber and over the full auto. And then obviously plasma is huge for me, as I hate running PIM particles, just because once you decrease the size of the enemy, it's really hard to get shots off with recoil and everything else. But plasma damage staggers and spreads like the COVID. It's beautiful. You guys get what I mean. And then moving on to the chest piece, it's just a stat stick, which means that we only use it for the stats. Taking damage grants defense buff is not a bad way to go. If you can go Jarvis, it's always great as well. But the idea is that you're wanting to run precision and valor. Resilience is great just to keep yourself alive. And then for the belt, now here's what I've been going back and forth with. I found this belt and I love it because it gives me 60 resilience and 48 power. Okay, chance on defeating enemies gives me a damage buff, which is phenomenal. And if you kill three enemies in rapid succession, which we always do, right, it grants you a defense buff. But I was also made aware that since I'm running the pistol builds and I get shots out so fast, that I should be running the third trait, where if you get 16 shots out without taking damage, that it would proc the damage buff for you. Now, I do have the damage buff being procced on the range gear set by using the power attack, which is when you hold down the left mouse button, and it's only a 16.7% chance, whereas if you have the 16 hits in succession back to back without taking damage, which you should do easily with a pistol build, granting you a damage buff would be phenomenal, just due to the fact that you can guarantee your damage buff rather than hoping for it and just going, well, can I get it, can I not? So that is definitely something to look out for. I would 100% agree to go with that instead of the one I have. It's just taking me a little bit more time to farm. Now moving on to the major artifact, I've been bouncing back and forth between the Ring of Mevalon and the Tactigon. The Tactigon is great, just to let you know, it's bugged at the moment. It states that it gives you 10.9% increased damage on enemies affected by any type of status. I've tested this for a good 5 hours, only to figure out that it is 8.679% and not the 10.9%. Now, everyone understands that it's only a 2% reduction, so it's not really a big deal, which I 100% agree with. But it is still bugged in a sense of way. The Ring of Nebulon is great. I actually use it when I'm clearing adds. And when it's time to go ahead and fight a boss like the Abomination or Taskmaster or something that's heavy, I switch over to my Tactigon just to get that extra oomph. For my minor artifacts, I end up running 3 stacks Valor. If I can have getter gear perks for that, like increased, you know, power attack damage would be great for my range. But so far I haven't found anything that's of use. So having 3 stacks of Valor and then 3 stacks of Precision has been working great for me, especially with the increased rate of my Heroic Assault ability, just because I use my Widow's Bite quite frequently. So seeing the gear, let me go ahead and pull up just the overall stats so that way you guys can see it. I am running 254 precision. It is, in my opinion, high, which is one of the reasons why I decided to put a little bit more into Valor. So I'm running 234 Valor just to give myself the critical damage. Now, I want you guys to remember at the beginning of the video, during the subtitles at the bottom, there's a reason why we're running 0 proficiency. Because if you stack your abilities right, you're running a little bit over 84-85% crit. So you don't need any points whatsoever in proficiency. I would rather stack Resolve over Resilience, just because Resolve gives you a lot greater defense rating than Resilience does, just due to the fact that the Resilience actually has diminishing returns, whereas Resolve does not. And you want 1 to 2 pieces maximum of intensity, just because the diminishing returns kicks in at around 41 intensity. So just having 45 up to 81 is great. Anything over 81, in my opinion, it's just it's a hit on your stats. Let's go ahead and take a look at the skills. I don't have to walk you guys through the primary, just because once you hit level 50, you will unlock every skill there is to have. Going into the specialty, this is where it kicks in a little bit, right? A lot of people will bounce back and forth between the two abilities here for the support heroic, right? The reason why I choose the critical attack damage, the Night Terror, for the critical attack damage itself, the critical attack chance, my apology, by 25%, it's huge. Plus, the increased duration of Veil of Shadows is also phenomenal, because you get the extra 3 seconds for the crit hit chance and the crit hit damage that you guys saw at the beginning of the video, plus the extra range attack damage for the extra 3 seconds, which is great. Now, all this, I would say, is phenomenal if you're fighting a boss fight. If you're clearing adds and you want to keep yourself in invisibility, the best thing, in my opinion, would be running a Shadow's Gift, just because as of right now, it is bugged. So the enemies defeated by Veil of Shadows is active have a 35% chance to drop a heroic orb. That is incorrect. As of right now, it is 100% guaranteed to drop orbs. So you go into stealth, you can pretty much just be pooping orbs left and right. You'll see them just getting chucked all over the place. All right, moving on. I love running Mortal Cloak. It's for myself. It depends if you're running with other people online. For companions, it's great, just because it gives everyone that extra 30% critical attack chance. Especially when I'm running multiplayer, I love using that over anything else, just because, you know, I want Thor to proc his support heroic for myself for the extra damage and crit damage. So it kind of just bounces back and forth. It's one of my favorite. The other two is A-OK. Right, increases the range of Veil of Shadows would be a second opinion for me. Having, you know, them coming out of stealth 5 seconds later isn't really a big deal for me. So it'd be one of two things. It's completely up to you whether you want to run Eclipse or Mortal Cloak. If you're just trying to clear everything, I would suggest Mortal Cloak, just because it gives everyone that extra 30% critical attack chance, which, as you can tell through proficiency, has a really high diminishing returns. The heart of this build is Taser Dart. Taser Dart, Taser Dart, Taser Dart. Okay, having it applies, it doesn't explode, it attaches itself to a target and applies shock damage, right? A lot of people tell you if you want to utilize the battery effect, you got to go ahead and wait until you stack up the actual full meter, right, for shock or for whatever status that you're using. This does it. The second you hit a boss with Taser Dart, they have full shock, you can start your battery effect right off the bat. And especially because I'm using plasma right now, the second I hit him with shock, I just start firing my bullets and it's all battery effect. It's all 200% damage on top of all the other numbers that you guys have, you know, originally seen. And you guys will see in the gameplay to come. Obviously you want to run Lethal Bite, just due to the fact that you want to have extra charges, because this does stick in a single target, so you have 1, 2, 3 total charges with it. And it's phenomenal. Again, you guys will end up seeing it in the gameplay and understand why I decided to choose this. You guys have seen at the very, very beginning, the first 5 seconds of this video, all these crazy 600 and 800k, 500 and 400k numbers. You guys will see why. In the Ultimate Heroic, increasing the damage of Widow's Bite while Power Surge is active by 20%, phenomenal. The amount of damage, sheer damage, that you're going to be just tossing out is going to be insane, especially with your crit hit chance being so high and your crit hit damage at 433%. This is the way to go. You wouldn't want to go any other way, right? This is the way. I have spoken. Don't go for anything except for Galvanic Bite, okay? You are also getting Power Grid, just because you want the duration of Power Surge increased by 4 seconds, due to the fact that, again, Power Surge ends up giving you the damage buff increase on its own. Let alone, you also want that extra oomph with Widow's Bite. What I did forget to put up, and that is a shame on me. I hate the fact that I didn't do this, because I didn't put this in my calculation, but being in Power Surge, you also get the pistol damage increase and reload speed increase by 20%. Okay. Phenomenal use. If you, I mean, this is one of the reasons why I'm running the pistol damage or the pistol shot instead of any of the other full auto or the high caliber. Okay. Under Mastery, for the intrinsic ability, running this is huge. As you can tell, it gives you that extra critical attack damage by overcharge by 15%. You're also running all attacks, increase the charge rate for intrinsic shadow ops, because again, you want to get into that shadow ops as soon as possible so that you can take advantage of your gloves, your ops flare, to get that extra 135% critical damage. Plus you end up getting that innate 20% damage while you're in shadow ops is also great, with the crit attack or crit hit chance as well. I was told to run this. I find this very reliable, increasing the delay by a second before the intrinsic shadow ops begins to deplete when I'm not attacking, just in case I'm trying to get health or I'm bouncing around, so on and so forth. I really don't pay attention much to range because I don't use my grenades as much, but having plasma is great just because it staggers them. So being able to throw that on the ground and letting the status damage linger around on the ground is phenomenal. And then it really depends. A lot of people can end up going for the extra 3 rounds per magazine for the pistol shot. I haven't found it to be that big of a deal. I shoot fairly fast, so I would love the recoil. I have tested it. It does work. It's not a big difference, but when you're playing a range class, at one point in time, you look at the 3 extra bullets, right? Which means more recoil because more magazine size. Plus sub 15%, you know, shot recoil reduction, it's just not worth it. For invisibility, you want to run the increased range attack damage while you're invisible. So it helps you if you end up running the 100% heroic orb generation. So that way, as soon as you go invisible, you're just killing everything in sight. You're also running the extended invisibility granted by Veil of Shadows by 2 seconds, just to keep you in it a little bit longer. And then increase attack damage while invisible is also huge. So that's how you end up getting to that 433% critical attack damage. Okay, for the utilities here, performing takedown spawns heroic orbs, which is great for you, and increasing your attack damage by 10%, which would be the only way to go. This is actually bugged at the moment. It was tested that it gives you 15%, whereas critical attack damage here doesn't give you 20%. It actually gives you 6.5%. So it's better to have the extra 15% innate damage that just sticks with you throughout the entire duration. And then you're running melee charges because your light and heavy attacks boost the energy of all heroic meters by 5%. There's really nothing else that you can do because you're not juggling enemies, you're playing range, right? And you're not using light and heavy combo finishers, so you don't need the extended damage. So having this is actually a lot more decent in comparison to anything else. So I'll go ahead and I'll put on a little bit of gameplay so that way you guys can see what I'm doing. And, you know, I would love for you guys to go ahead and let me know what you guys think about the build. There we go. And it's spread. I love it. I love it.
This may shock you.
Or both the jungle strong as Black Widow could be. Thank you. Greatly appreciate it. Spread that plasma.
There they are.
Abomination clone is defeated. Well done, Avenger.
I just don't know. Just in case everybody's wondering, yes, this is Elite Villain Sector. Yes, this is Challenge 4. I just don't know what to tell you. Black Widow is my favorite ever of all times. Thank you. There's Challenge 4, as you can see. She is literally the best. I want you to take a moment right now, pause this video, like, comment, subscribe, tell me how awesome you think she is, and please, please, if you find something to make this build better, let me know. We are here to destroy. I mean, honestly, insert Step Brothers clip. We're here to fuck shit up. Y'all have a wonderful day. Love you. Sub. Let me know what you think. Later.